keep them separated, I don't know.
Thank you. Thank you. Makes my heart like a cacophony. Blush on my cheek whenever you speak.
eager heart with
saith unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father. And how saith thou, show us the Father? Believe thou not that I am the Father, and the Father in me. The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but of the Father that dwelleth in me. He doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me. Or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that liveth on me, believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also a greater work than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father.
Thank you. point, 11 o'clock, yeah. So we're going to start at 11.
Okay. All right, Chris.
You want to sit in my office, you can sit here.
Okay, well, if you say the 11, what time is it? We
there. It's about 10:28, 10:30.
Okay. But, okay, so you want to wait to start because the hymn of comfort.
Yeah, but service starts at 11, so it's viewing from 10.
Oh, that's right. Cool. 10. Okay. All right.
So there's well, people there coming out.
All right. Okay. All right, so where is it?
morning, everybody. Praise God. At this time, we're going to have, well, they got this here. Usually the prayer comfort. We're going to have the reading of the scriptures, the Old and New Testament. First of all, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out to honor this family and the loss of their dear loved one, Mr. Nathaniel Butler. We praise God for this family and for a life well lived. And even though our hearts may be aching, this is a true celebration of life, because I was telling the family, When a person lives a beautiful life, every day is their message. That's a sermon in itself. You don't have, look, I don't have to preach hard, so you know you can get a two-second message. Praise God. All right, at this time, I'm going to read the scriptures from the Old Testament. We have Psalms 121. This was Mr. Butler's favorite scripture. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help come from the Lord, which made the heaven and earth. He will not suffer my foot to be moved. He that keepeth Israel, he that keepeth thee, will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. And the eighth verse, the Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this day forth and forevermore. Now for the second scripture, which is from the New Testament, is in John 3:16. And I think most of y'all should know John 3:16 by heart. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And at this time, we've just read the scriptures. The word has already been blessed. Receive it into your hearts and don't allow any distractions to come into your mind. We want to stay prayed up for the family and for each other because we love Mr. Butler. That's why we're here. We're not here for a form or to put on a show, but we're here because we love a man that was well loved by his family and his friends. So at this time, we're going to have the prayer of comfort from Father Michael Rock. Praise God.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. And especially to Marion, to you and all the family. From all of us at the parish, we offer our deepest sympathy and loss during your time of mourning. We do celebrate, though, as the minister said, we celebrate the joy of the fact that James has gone back to the Lord and is with him. And there's no more suffering or pain. There's only happiness. And there he prepares a place for all of you so you can share it with him. So as we pray for all of you today, because that's really what the funeral's for. It's for us. It's for us to celebrate our faith, our life, our memories. And it's for us to celebrate the goodness of this man who touched each of you with love and comfort. So we're going to offer these intercessions. And I ask at the end of each of them, you join me by saying, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for Nathaniel James, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints with Christ. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for our brother who was nourished with the body and blood of Jesus, the bread of life, May he now be raised up to share in the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all of our deceased relatives and friends, for all who have blessed us and helped us. May they have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord. We pray for all who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord. We pray for you, Marion, for all of James' children, his great-grandchildren. May you be consoled in your grief. Jesus himself wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. May he now wipe the tears from your eyes and give you comfort, strength, and hope, we pray to the Lord. We are all assembled here. We gather in faith and worship to thank God for the gift of James's life, of his love, of his service to country and service to family. May he now be in that kingdom of peace and happiness, we pray to the Lord. Let us together unite our prayers as Jesus taught us by using those words, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power, the kingdom, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the words of St. Paul to Timothy sum up the life of James Butler, and we reflect on those words as St. Paul writes, I am already being poured out like a libation. The time of my departure is at hand. I have competed well. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And from now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. And let us pray. God of endless ages, from one generation to the next, you have been our refuge and our strength. Before the mountains were born or the earth came to be, you are God. Have mercy now on your servant Nathaniel James Butler, whose long life was spent in your service. Give him a place in the kingdom where hope is firm for all who love and rest is sure for all who have served. And we ask this prayer through Jesus our Savior. Amen.
I want to thank Father Rob for the prayer of comfort for this family. At this time, we're going to have a selection by Robin S. Figueroa. I'm sorry. Is she here?
Giving honor to God, to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we'd like to thank everybody here that came out to celebrate with us the life of our grandfather. And we want to give God the glory, honor, and praise through singing.
Amen.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for my heavenly home? when Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. What? I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow. And I know he watches. He watches me.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for my heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches. He watches me.
I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow,
and I know he watches. He watches me. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Sisters, for such a beautiful song, because his eye is on the sparrow, and because he live, we live also, and we have that assurance that he's watching over us. At this time, we're going to have the acknowledgement of condolences. Celebrate your memories, and in these memories, may you find comfort. To Mrs. Butler, Our loved ones are a gift to us. After they have gone, we remember and we celebrate the life they lived, the love they shared, the difference they made in our lives. Thinking of you at this difficult time, from Kyle and Sharon Mitchell and your neighbors. Praise God. Memories build a special bridge, a message of sympathy by Emily Matthews. Our memories build a special bridge when loved ones have to part to help us feel we're with them still and soothe a grieving heart. They span the years and warm our lives, preserving ties that bind. Our memories build a special bridge and bring us peace of mind. Always remember the good times, Marion and family, thinking about you and wishing you courage to help you to help see you through day by day, and hoping your memories will warm your heart always and bring so much comfort your way. With heartfelt sympathy, stay strong, sincerely, Jane Moten. With caring sympathy in the loss of your husband, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted, Matthew 5:4. With God, love lives forever. May the compassion of those who care surround you, the memories of shared joys encourage you, and the warmth of God's love embrace you. God be with you, Miss Cardell. With caring sympathy in the loss of your husband, blessed are these are those who mourn, for they will be comforted, Matthew 5:4. Mrs. Butler, with God, love lives forever. May the compassion of those who care surround you, the memories of shared joys encourage you, and the warmth of God's love embrace you. From Shirley, Dinah Care. With sympathy in the loss of your husband. No time on earth is long enough to share with you those we love. Nothing can prepare our hearts to say goodbye. Mrs. Marion Butler and family, may the sympathy of those who care about you and your precious memory of your husband help to comfort you at this time. From Sissy and family. At this time, we just had the reading of the cards. At this time, we're going to have remarks, and there's a limit of 2 minutes. At this time, will those that have remarks, if you will line up on either side or just come. Do we have anyone that's coming to give a testimony from the family or friends? All right, at this time, we're going to have Brother Charles. Praise God.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, family. I'm not going to be long. You know, there's a lot I got to say. I can sit here and preach and say a whole lot about my brother-in-law because, you know, in the later years, we became real close. And we had a lot of discussions. We talked about religion, politicians, this life and period. And what he shared with me was knowledge, which that was a gift that he gave me. It was more than material, money, cars, whatever you want. But the knowledge that he gave me was like a gold mine, you know, of life. And I appreciate what he did. He was a man that when we had these conversations, and I would say something, he would say, "Butch." He would say, "Where'd you hear that from?" And I, you know, I had to think about what I put out there, and I had to answer it, because when I put it out there and I couldn't answer it, he'd look at me, and he said, "Don't play with me, you know, be for real." So he was a real brother. He was like a bigger brother to me. He was a father image to me. I learned from him because he showed love. You know, he loved my sister. He showed me that. He loved his family, regardless of how good or bad they were. He still showed love. He cared for them. And he showed me a whole lot. And I appreciated him. Appreciate what he gave me. So as a man, a father, a husband, I salute him. Brother-in-law, you was a great man. Thank you.
Amen. We want to thank Brother Charles for that. I want to thank him because we got to liven up. Is there any other testimonies? Would you come forth, please?
Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
So first I want to say, Grandma, I love you. I'm here for you. Even though I'm not in Philly, I'm here for you. So you can call me anytime you want. Grandpa, I called him GP. Probably like 6-7 years old, he started walking me to school every day. And I used to get annoyed because he would talk to everybody in the neighborhood. And I'd be like, "Yo, I'm ready to get home. Like, I want to get in front of the TV. I want to eat food. I want to go outside and play basketball." But he would talk to everybody in the neighborhood. And during that time, I didn't realize that he was just such a people person. He loved people. And it rubbed off on me because as I got older, I loved to talk to people. So when me, him, and Uncle Emery would sit down in the kitchen and just talk, we'd be in there for hours. And I remember Grandma would be like, "Well, y'all just shut up." Because we would just talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. And they would always talk about, you know, history and what they, you know, what they went through growing up. And Grandpa, you know, being in Brooklyn and being in Baltimore. And similar to what Uncle Butch said, he was always willing to share his knowledge and wisdom. That's all he wanted to do. He never gave me anything material. I mean, the first gift he ever gave me materially was like last year when I got married, and he gave me, you know, gave me a couple bucks. But for that, all he ever gave me was just unconditional love. He always believed in me. He always wanted to hear what I was thinking and what I was feeling. You know, we sit down and talk about politics, and we go back and forth. We talk about religion and go back and forth, and, you know, sports. We just always had conversation, and he wasn't just my grandpa, he was my friend. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was somebody who I know I could pick up the phone and call him, and we could just have conversations. So, you know, I wanted to come up here and just, you know, just say thank you for not just being a good grandpa and stepping up in ways and at times where, you know, as your grandson, I need you to just step up.
Praise God.
But also thank you for being my friend, because that's what you were.
Amen. Praise God. Would you come forth, please? And I'm sorry they didn't have wipes out here to wipe this down behind everybody, but. You got some? Where are they? Oh, can I have them?
Praise God. You know this thing we're going through is real, right? Yeah. We're trying to keep it 100. Thank you.
My name is Charlie. I'm the son-in-law of a pop. I mean, as much as you could say to a man that was everything. He was everything to me. He was everything to everybody. And he was a great man. The lifestyle that I lived, I always wished that I could be the man that Pop was. I mean, he was an awesome father. He was an awesome husband. He was an awesome friend. He was just an awesome human being. And I mean, we all have faults, but you had to look far and wide to find a fault in Pop. Because Pop, he was the truth. And there's so many words and so many things I can say. I mean, he's been my Pop for 49 years. We never had an argument. Well, we had some disagreements because I was a hard-headed and stubborn, and he was telling me, put me on the right path. I didn't want to hear it, you know what I mean? Because I thought, you know, he old. But he said, you've been there and done that. He said, you'll see what I'm saying is true. And many, many times I experienced what he said that would have been true, that if I'd have listened to him, my life would have been much better, you know? And what I have to say is that I love him. I loved him then, I love him now, and I will always love him. And he'll always have a place in my heart because I, even going through what I go through now, his examples resonate in my mind. Amen. And I live out his examples in my everyday life. I just wanted to say, Pop, I love you. I miss you. And if it wasn't for you, I don't think I'd be the man that I am today. Thank you.
Amen. Praise God. Is there another? Do we have anyone else? Okay. If that's it, then we have, we're going to play his favorite song. And I'm glad we have a microphone. Thank God for technology, because they gave me the words to the song. And I said, I didn't want to mess it up. So what I'm going to do is play it for you. So just be patient. I want to thank everyone for coming out. First, I want to give honor to God, who is the head of my life, to all the ministers that are here, and any E-man that's here. Because God has no respect of person. He loves all his children. And once we learn that God don't have no respect of person, we'll be doing the things that he called us to do, to work together and to have harmony with one another. Okay. Gosh. I had it turned off because I didn't want to do any disturbance. Okay, let me see. Bear with me. The song is called I'm Going to Miss You. So I want everyone to listen. Listen to the words of the song. Yes, I am.
to go.
I don't know if somebody's trying to call.
In your finest
hour.
I was there with you.
These words are so beautiful. Never end. The obituary reading by Calvin Jones III. Praise God.
Nathaniel James Butler was the fifth child born into the union of the late Albert Butler Sr.
Take that mask off so you can talk into the mic.
Okay. I'll protect myself.
No, we want you to look. We being vigilant about this, but praise God.
Okay? All right, so I'll start over. Nathaniel James Butler was the fifth child born into the union of the late Albert Butler Sr. and Gertrude Butler on August 6, 1933 in Baltimore, Maryland. After a lengthy illness, he departed this life on March 24, 2021, at home with his family. James was educated in Baltimore, Maryland, and Brooklyn, New York school districts, where he attended Franklin K. High School. After high school, he served in the United States Army, as well as the Army Reserve, for a total of 8 years and received an honorable discharge. He married Marion Lee Jones on November 28, 1958. And from that union, they had 6 children. James worked at the University of Pennsylvania and McNeil Pharmaceutical Firm as a medical laboratory research technician in Fort Washington, Pennsylvania. He also worked part-time at Sears in Upper Darby, PA. James loved working on cars, playing the Pennsylvania lottery every day, and talking to everyone who he came in contact with. He was the true definition of a people's person. James is preceded in death by his 3 brothers, Earl Butler, Emmerich Butler, and Albert Butler Jr., 4 sisters, Doris Randolph, Ethel Perkins, Dolores Butler, and Clara Butler, two grandchildren, Charles Huey Lawrence Jr., and Dante S. Butler.
James leaves to cherish his memories, his wife of 62 years, Marion Lee Jones, 6 children, Angela Lawrence, Marion Butler, Anna Marie Merritt, Natalie Estellero, Josephine Butler, and Antoine Butler. Two sons-in-laws, Charles H. Lawrence Sr. and Ramon Estellero Sr. One daughter-in-law, Deborah Keller Butler. Brother and sister-in-laws, Charles Lee Jr. and Agnes Lee. 16 grandchildren, Tiffany Waters, Fatima Estellero Perlo, Robin Figueroa, Robert Merritt Jr., as we affectionately know as BJ, Takea Gwynn, Omar Lawrence, who we affectionately know as Pun, Nadira Keller Butler, Ramon Estellero Jr., who we affectionately know as Chucky. We're a family of nicknames. Tamir Gwynn, Sabri Estellero, Naima Butler, Khalid Jones, Natasha Butler, and myself, Calvin Jones, who I'm known as Weeby, and who my grandpa called CJ. 5 grands-in-laws, Gary Waters, Carlos Figueroa, Marilyn Estellero, Clayton Jones, and Thaqui Perlo. There's also 24 great-grandchildren who I'm not going to go through because we'll be here all day.
No, go ahead.
All right, I'll go through them. Taquil Estellero, Randy Glover, India Glover, Romeo Glover, Stefan Glover, Genuine Glover, Treasure Glover, Romello Glover, Damir Diggs, who we affectionately know as Rock, Asia Gwynn, Masir Gwynn, Anya Gwynn, Dante Gwynn, Dijon Waters, who we affectionately know as DJ, Jaden Waters, Isaiah Lawrence, Sienna Figueroa, Brianna Figueroa, Ariana Figueroa, Hafiz Brooks, Alana Estellero, Mia Estellero, Juliana Estellero, and Kendricks Jackson Jones, as well as a host of nieces and nephews, lovingly submitted by the family. There's been several submissions in terms of letters to my grandpa, who I know there's a few people who are going to want to come up and read their own, but I'm going to pick the two that was submitted by my grandmother, his wife, as well as the children. Amen. When I lost you, I wish I could see you one more time, come walking through the door, but I know that is impossible. I will hear your voice no more. I know you can feel my tears and you don't want me to cry. Yet my heart is broken because I can't understand why. Someone so precious had to die. I pray that God will give me strength and somehow get me through as I struggle with the heartache that came when I lost you. Love your wife and best friend.
Oh, beautiful.
And missing you, Dad. Sometimes we wish for you to come back, but we don't want you to suffer again. Know that you are with us, and we will always love and miss you with all of our hearts. Until we all meet again, we love you, Dad, your children.
Good morning. My name is Takea Gwynn, and this is to my grandfather. It's entitled, I'm Not Ready. Grandpa, I'm not ready to say goodbye. I still have more questions about life decisions that I know you have the answer to. I can still hear you saying, Ty, slow down, you talk so fast. Or you answering the doorbell yelling, who is it? As I respond, it's me, Grandpa. I'm not ready to stop hearing you call out the nicknames of your grands and your great-grands. Excuse me. Such as Ty, Mimi, Noonie Lid, CJ Rock, just to name a few. I'm not ready to no longer hear the lottery at 6:59 p.m. while you're writing down the lottery numbers before stuffing them in your shirt pocket or sliding them under the table mat. I'm not ready to come in the house to not see you sitting at the table preparing to talk politics, excuse me, or the Eagles. When you were no longer able to sit at the table, our conversations continued in the middle bedroom. As I fed you chicken and rice soup, ice chips, and held you a cup of water.
All right, take your time. It's okay.
I'm not ready. I'm not ready to no longer say, Grandpa, show me your trigger finger. As you will respond with bang, bang, bang. One of my last conversations was me telling you I'm not ready for you to go. Excuse me. And your response was, I'm not ready to go. When God is ready, is nothing anyone can do but follow his lead. Mm-hmm. Well, Grandpa, you fought a good fight, and although I was not ready for you to go, God was ready, and you followed his lead. Mm-hmm. So because I'm not ready to say goodbye, I will tearfully say, see you later. I love you, Grandpa, a.k.a. my forever angel.
Beautiful. Amen. Let's give our hand. Praise God. So this is a celebration of love. This is the love. Let me wipe this thing down. Ooh, Jesus.
Amen. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Okay, we're trying to
keep it like that so they can hear you. Praise God.
Good morning, everybody. My name's Khalid. Everybody in here know me as Lid. This is a letter to my grandfather. A simple letter can't do you justice. You are truly one of the good guys. A great brother, father, grandfather, and husband. You meant so much to us all. Mm-hmm. I'll always remember how much time we spent together. From living together when I was really young, to walking me home from school every single day. Walking me home from school every single day for years, along with a couple of my friends from the neighborhood here and there. You were the greatest people person that I've ever seen. You were impossible not to love. Your only flaw was never hitting on any of them numbers you played daily. I remember all of those walks home, the knowledge given, but most of all, how you listen and how you were willing to listen to anything, any and every problem and growing pain in that short 10-minute walk from Lourdes at 2227. You unconditionally love 6 children, 16 grandchildren, and 24 great-grandchildren. Mm-hmm. You were so very special to us all, and I just hope you know how much you meant to me and how much I love you. Hopefully I made and can continue to make you proud. Until we meet again, my dog, love Lit.
Amen. Let's give him a hand. Praise God. Amen. Yeah. I don't know if we've gotten everybody. Is that?
Did we?
Is that everybody? Or did we have another one? Okay, well then. Now we're going to have a song. Oh, when I come to the end of my journey. Let's see if I can. And this here song, I'm so glad that his children know him, because I was talking to several daughters and they kept telling me, the song is, Oh, When I Come to the End of My Journey. And I was looking it up on the phone because I said, well, I don't know this song. And I was coming up with country western music. So then we waited for the youngest daughter to come. They say, she know what my dad was singing. And so when she played it for me, and it took me back to the 50s and 60s, because I grew up in the church where they would have testimony. We had to be in church 2 nights a week, all night long, tarrying for the Holy Ghost. And the song, one person would get up and start singing it, and they would carry it for an hour. So this is how I knew the words, when it said, oh, when I come to the end of my journey. I didn't know until the youngest daughter played it for me, and it was by Rosetta Thorpe. So I'm going to ask you all to bear with me as I try to do this for you. Thank you. Look, they had asked me to sing.
All right.
And I was prepared to sing. But when I was in the store shopping, Cookie called me and say, we want to know, can you do the eulogy? And I said, I had told the Lord to increase my territory, but not this fast. Because I had been in a drought for a while. You know, sometimes we go through trials and tribulations and things come. And even though we're called to do a work for the Lord, we can get sidetracked. And we sometimes we're sitting on the side just like Moses. So don't think you all that in a bag of chips up in here. Truly, I want to give honor to God, who is the head of my life, to his son, Jesus Christ, to all the ministers of the gospel, the imams and all the Muslims. I truly thank God for being here today to honor a life that is well lived. Lord, we give you thanks right now for who you are. And I ask y'all to bear with me as I come forth, thanking God for his goodness, because every day we're going through something in this world. And I want you to turn. And this is so crazy. I didn't know Mr. Butler that well, but I got to know him through his family. And I'm so glad I had a chance to spend time, because when she had just asked me to sing, I knew of her parents, but I didn't know them. But I've been knowing her daughter, Cookie, and Ice for a long time. We go back to, I guess, when I moved around here in 68. And I had a brother that was, well, he was like an outlaw. He was an alcoholic, but God changed him. But I thank God for the love that they had back then, that the Lord changed my brother. And I thank God my brother knew the Butlers, and they were very encouraging to him. And that's what we need today as true believers and saints, because the Bible says a true witness brings deliverance, a false witness tells lies. And so I was talking to a brother that was at the house, and you know, like iron sharpeneth iron, Brother Charles, he started asking me some questions. And see, I believe this is a homegoing, this is a celebration, because this man lived a beautiful life. I mean, it's nothing we would like if he could have been here longer. But you see, God has a time for every one of us. You know that? You may not know it as good as you look sitting out, and y'all look good. You look beautiful. And I want to thank all those that came up here and participated, because it means so much. See, when we celebrate the life, it's not about this spirit is gone. This is a perfect state right here. Y'all may not know it, but the Bible say to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, because God is a spirit. And when God claims what belongs to him, and the spirit of a man belongs to him, because the God that we serve, he gives the breath of life. He's the only one can take it away. He has that power. Power belongs to God. And so when I look at this man lives so well, I'm proud that, see, y'all don't want to put on a mask to go to the store, you know that, but we can tell this man was well loved, because you was willing to take the time, put on a mask, and then come out here and sit to just honor this family. And I thank God for that, for all the children that came forth. But I was talking to Brother Charles, and he had told me, had given me a scripture to read. And see, sometimes we're not really hearing. He told me one scripture, and I ended up reading another scripture. He said, what are you reading? I said, well, I thought that's what you told me. He said, no, that's not the scripture I told you. He said, I told you to read Habakkuk. And so then when I began to read it, but what is so good about God? I hadn't prepared to bring a message from Habakkuk. But after I got home and started reading even more, I realized that I asked God first, I prayed, and then I got into the scripture with Habakkuk. And so today I'm going to read, come before you with Habakkuk, the second chapter. Let me get it right now. The second chapter. Here it is. Okay, the second chapter, verses 1-4. And it reads for your hearing. I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what
he will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon the tables, that he may run the that he may run that readeth it, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end of it shall, at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith. Heavenly Father, we come right now to honor you and to thank you. And Lord, we ask you to let people lose sight on each other and to just hear your word. Let the Holy Spirit take control in the mighty name of Jesus, because we came now to honor your servant who you blessed to make the transition, God. And we're so grateful, because that's the transition we all have to make. He has now become one of our ancestors that sits high and looks low. And we praise God for that. So we thank you for the opportunity to honor this family today, God. We ask you to throw your loving arms around them. Cover them in the name of Jesus. Protect them and continue to lift them up as they go through in the morning stages, Lord. There's times when they will feel good and sometimes they won't feel so good. But because you're with them, God, they can make it. So we thank you right now for being who you are, because power belongs to you and it's all in your control. We thank you now for the word that's coming forth. And Lord, don't let it fall on deaf ears, but let it fall on good ground so that it will spring up in the people the everlasting life, that they may see this brother Butler again one day on the other side. We thank you in Jesus' name. Okay, at this time I'm going to go into where Rebecca had complaints. I won't be before you too long, because during this pandemic, we don't want to hold people too long and drag them out, because this funeral is not about a 3-point, 5-point message. Everybody here knows something about the Lord. But the main thing that you need to know, that Rebecca was a praying man. And when he went to God, he was angry because God allowed the Chaldeans to come in and destroy and tear up the children of Israel, the Hebrews. And he went to God with his complaint. His first complaint was, Lord, why would you send these people when they're more wicked than us? When these people are terrible and all, and you sending them to terrorize us, that was his first complaint. But he didn't just complain, because he got on his knees and he began to pray and ask God about it. And the second complaint was, why are you allowing these people to torture your children day and night, when he was saying they weren't too bad? But you know, we've all sinned and come short of God's glory. And we're living in that day now, because the trials and the tribulations are so bad that we're facing. You thought that when you got through 2020, you thought that getting into 21 was going to be a great change. And so we was hoping and praying, and we done voted and did everything that we knew to do. And what happened? Things begin to get worse. But you know what? I found out that God is still on the throne. And like Rebecca had said, the just shall live by faith. Not only shall they live by faith, I want you to know God is still in control. And because he's in control, we don't look like what we're going through. Because everybody in here is struggling with something. If it ain't the bills, it's your health. If it ain't your health, it's the children. If it's not that, it's your neighbor. Something is going on in everybody's life. And this is why we have to pray and be vigilant and know who God is for ourselves. Because if you're not careful, your emotions can get you in the wrong place at the wrong time. And that's why Rebecca was a praying man. But after he went to God with his complaints, he got satisfied. We don't know how long it took for God to answer him. What we do know, he got an answer, because the verses after that said that he began to reap for joy. And he began to say how good God was, because he found out that God was going to not only take care of the people that had hurt his people, but he was a true and righteous judge. And that's why he said that we walk by faith And so faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You know, when you have faith, and the Bible says if you have the faith of a grain of mustard seed, I hear a lot of people talking about, oh, did you get the vaccine? Well, I ain't getting it. You know they're trying to kill the black people. Then I talk to the white people, they say, you know they're trying to kill us. Because I've talked to people on both sides. And so it's a preference you have, but because it is a virus out here, and God has given some man the mind to create a vaccine, I thought it was a good thing. Now, if your body is up to par and you're doing all the right things, because they say most of the people are dying, they have a low vitamin D level. But we're not here to judge or to predict or tell people how to do. All I know is 30 years ago, 40 years ago, people was walking around and you see them talking and you knew they had mental issues, right? But now everybody walking and talking got a cell phone. Everybody got a phone. Little children walking and talking. Why? Because a man invented something that we could all use, we could all profit with, and you can't do without it, because after the pandemic came, everything is being done online. You can't even go. If you call them, they say, well, go online. You know, so those that thought they didn't have to, like me, use the computer, now you have to become computer savvy, because this is the way things are going. But what I love about Habakkuk, he began to pray to God. So when God showed him how he was going to move and bless his children, and he began to reap for joy, because he said, this is the God of my salvation, and I will joy in him, because trusting in him and walking by faith has made it possible for him to do the thing. So God became his joy. But I want to say that even though you're going through these trials and tribulations, even though it looks bad right now because the government, they're upset. Nobody can agree to the Republicans and the Democrats are at each other's throat day and night. And the money that they're giving out, the stimulus money, is not enough, because a lot of people that had business lost their business. But you see, we learned how to live off a little bit of nothing. And you're talking about walking by faith. There's people that was losing their apartments, their houses, the business, everything, because they didn't know how to manage. And when the government start cutting things off, people that never knew that they could call on God begin to pray. And they begin to trust him more. And that's what happened to these here, the Jewish people. They were disobedient to God. But after he had prayed, Habakkuk had prayed, they began to mend their ways, and God began to heal their land. And so he told them to trust him. In the fourth verse, it says, the just shall live by faith. It takes faith for you to walk out this door, because we don't know where trouble or death is. And the way things are going now, so many young people are mixed up and they're angry and they're hurt. There's been so much racial tension. And this is not a new thing, racial tension, because back in history, we had the Jews and the Samaritans. They didn't deal with one another. When Jesus met the woman at the well, she wanted to know, why did he even speak to her? This is how people feel today. Why did he even asked her for a drink? But when he told her, if you knew who it was within me that asked of you, you would have asked of me, and I would have given you this living water. And that's when she got curious, and she said, well, what kind of water? She got interested. What kind of water is this? That's in the fourth chapter of John. And so when he told her, she said, I want this water. He said, go call your husband. And she looked at him and she said, I have no husband. He told her, you spoke the truth, because you had five, and the one you have now is not yours. And she said, I perceive this man to be a prophet. See, when God began to deal with us one-on-one, he deals with the reality of our life. He makes it plain and he breaks it down. And this is why we have to trust him. Not only did she run through the streets and tell the men and bring them to Jesus, but when they heard it from him, they said, we're not coming to Jesus because of her testimony. We are coming because we heard for ourselves and we believe. And that's what it's about today. We have to gird up our lawn. This is what a funeral, I used to think when you go to a funeral, you're going to bless the family and the dead and to get plenty of good food or liquor if you drink or whatever they have to celebrate. But I found out as I began to get older in my years that this is everybody that's here Thank God for Mr. Butler. This was an invitation for you to come and to get right with Almighty God. Because, see, this is a preparation thing. You know, people think, oh, I'm just going. No, you coming because you need to hear. This spirit has already left the body. He's in a perfect state because he's with the Lord. But those of us that are alive and remain, we got to pray now because we're going to have to get in this same state. We don't know whether it's today, tomorrow, or the next day. But we know we're not going to stay up in this body. And some young people have a thing. They think because they're young that it's okay to do any kind of way. And young people are leaving here so fast today, saints. They're leaving here. And I've lost loved ones through violence. And so many of us. And we wondered, why did they have to be taken? But God still claims, even if it leaves, if they leave in a violent act, God claims what belongs to him. Because so many people get shot up and cut up, and they're still here. Because their time was not yet. But I want you to know you have a time that's expiring. We just don't know when it is. So while you have this time, I want you to search your heart and get right with God. And accept him. This invitation is coming through Mr. Butler, and that's why we all here, because we loved him. He lived for the Lord. He lived a beautiful life. And that song that he loved, oh, when I come to the end of my journey, and his wife told me how she didn't even like to go out to the store after he got sick because of the love she had for her husband and because the love the children had. They stayed and they prayed and they worked. And sometimes you have confusion. But God, in the midst of that, God is moving because, see, God is still in control. That's why we have to trust him. Trust him no matter how bad it gets. Even when the good times, we got to still trust him. So that's what I want to leave you, that fourth verse. The just shall live by faith. And this is where we are, trusting God, knowing that this is not the end. If you live for him, if you accept him, you're going to see Brother Butler again. You're going to see him again one day. You're going to see the other relatives, the loved ones that we lost, because this is not the end. This is just a transmission from one state into another. But because we haven't had anybody to come back except Jesus to tell us how it is on the other side, we really don't understand. And sometimes it's hard because we didn't get a chance to say what we wanted to. We didn't get a chance to do what we wanted to for that person, and they're taken away. But God knows their heart, and he knows that this family is going to be strong and come together in harmony, because this is what Mr. Butler wanted. That's why he said, oh, when I come to the end of my journey, weary of life, the battle is won. Carrying the cross of redemption, he understands, and he's saying, well done to him, but I want it to be well done with all of you out there. So at this time, I'm not going to take any more of your time. At this time, I'm going to have a prayer. I don't want to call anyone out, but I just want you to bow your heads, because so many times we like to single people out. Oh, well, you that don't know the Lord, come up here. Or you that you just been a backslider. See, God, we don't have to do that. We can just bow our heads, because all of us, we're all in need of prayer. We all need to get closer to the Messiah. We all need to trust him more and lean not unto our own understanding, because Zechariah 4:6 says, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. And God is a spirit. He's saying they that worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Because, see, you can't get on the phone and call God up or send him an email or a text. But your spirit man, once you accept him, knows God. And that's how you communicate. When I was growing up, we didn't have the games the children had planned. We had games that we would run outside and play tag and you're it. And we used to say apple, peaches, pumpkin pie. Who's not ready? Holler, I. And they would say, I. And then they said again, apple, peaches, pumpkin pie, who not ready, holler, ah. And they say, I. But after a while, whoever was the one to catch the people would say, ready or not. Here, and this is how God is. Whether you're ready or not, he's coming. And so I want you to accept that he's coming for a church without a spot or wrinkle. And let me tell you, we all got some wrinkles. So you're not going to get rid of any of that until you come. Even when you accept him, you still got things. People think, oh, I joined the church. Mm-mm. It takes time and seasons to change a man's life. But as we grow and we begin to pull off this old man, then the newness of Christ comes in. Then we can see and share with our brothers and sisters. We can share with our, because some of us are so judgmental and condemning. And I found out the difference between a flower that God's planting and a weed is a judgment. And we've been judging too many people. We just pull them up like weeds and throw them away. Pull them up. Oh, they ain't right. And who give you that authority? He said, if you see your sister and brother need you to bear them up, encourage one another in love, correct one another in love. And that's what this is about. This is what this man demonstrated all his life, the love. I listened to his grandson saying how what he gave me was wisdom. And that's the greatest gift. That's what Solomon asked God to give him when he was leading the people. He didn't ask for money like so many of them. He said, just give me wisdom to lead your people. And because he asked for wisdom, this is what God did for him. He said, I'm going to give you everything. Because wisdom is the greatest thing we can have to understand and care for one another. So at this time, I'm going to ask everybody to bow their heads so that we can pray for one another. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word, that we are to trust you no matter what. Because the just shall live by faith. Because God, you alone are still in control. So we ask you to cover every head in here today, every child, God, every family member, even those that are not here, God. We're asking you to draw them closer and lift them up, God, where they belong as you see fit. Because God, you're the creator, the great creator. You're the potter and we're the clay. And we know sometimes you got to beat us until we get it right. You got to mold us and shape us until we can see who you really are. So we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for all the speakers that came, all the wonderful singers. We thank you for Father Rock. We thank you, God, for this family. We ask you to just hold them in the center of your heart, God. Lift them up and don't let them fall, because they're going to have some lean days. We ask you to cover those that don't really know you, God. Give them a better understanding, because God, you said that you're love. And if we love you, then you're in us and we're in you, and we represent you in the fullness of your Holy Spirit. So we thank you now and we honor you by saying, Lord, let us be more like you and trust you no matter what, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. And at this time, let me get my program. At this time, we're going to ask the family to stand. We're going to do the final viewing. Praise God.
I need you, you need me, we're all a part of God's body. Stand with me, agree with me, we're all a part of God's body. It is His will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me, agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is His will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. To me, I need you to survive.
I pray for you.
I pray for you. You pray for me.
I love you.
I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive.
It is His will that every need be supplied.
You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
You are important.
You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. Harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. For you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive.
I won't harm you
with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive.
It is His will
that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
I pray for you.
I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive.
His will
that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Jennifer Palmer. Come right up.
Thank you, Brother Robert.